The Netflix original series Squid Game has taken the world by storm. First, it was set to become the biggest foreign language success, but now it's poised to become the best performing show on the platform. So what is it about this high concept Korean thriller that has audience so entranced? Aside from great writing, stellar performances, and an eye-catching name, we think it's got to do with the complex characters. We know they're good and that they're well-written, but how good are they from a moral perspective? Hello, I'm Caleb from WickedBinge, and today we'll be ranking Squid Game characters from good to evil. And before we begin, if you love Squid Game, make sure you check out our video 10 movies and shows to watch if you love Squid Game on our horror channel, Blood Binge. We've compiled our best recommendations if you love the genre. We also create videos on horror franchises of all kinds, including videos in our good to evil formats. So make sure you check them out. Remember to check out our video 10 things to watch if you love Squid Games over on our horror channel, Blood Binge. Just a few rules before we jump in, since what's a game script without any rules, right? There are a lot of characters in Squid Game. Like, there are 456 people just playing the game, not to mention the host, organizers, staff, and the majority of the people who have never heard of this. So our first rule is that we'll only be featuring prominent players or those we feel are exceptionally skewed to one side of the moral spectrum. As always, we'll be separating the cast into three categories: the good, the gray area, and the bad to evil. Obviously, in a show like Squid Game's, morality is very relative, but we'll be digging into that soon. Our last note for you is that, though this should be a given, there is a huge spoiler warning going into effect now. With all of that out of the way, we're gonna go ahead and start the contestant clocks, just try not to get eliminated before the end. As usual, we'll be starting with the purest of the characters and working our way down. So, first up are the good. We'd like to start by talking about the family. This is an unconventional and largely symbolic pick, but we feel it's important to address. With a few notable exceptions, most of the players have someone on the outside to represent the life they want to return to. In each case, this is someone deserving, someone struggling, and represents the best in the players themselves. For Sang-woo, this is his mother. For Ali, it's his wife. Kang Se-byuk has her little brother, and Ji-hoon has his mother and his daughter. In all instances, these are innocent characters who give the players motivation to continue playing.
We gotta keep an eye out. It'll be dangerous.
They make life brighter on the outside and promise a future that is worth fighting for. While some may be more sinless than others in a stricter sense, they all come together to form our top pick. Symbology aside, the character we have deemed as most good is Ji-young, aka Player 240. She's not perfect, nobody on this list is, but the crimes we see her commit with our own two eyes are virtually non-existent. She's standoffish, perhaps a little rough around the edges, but she's been through some shit. If the worst thing she does during the game is make fun of someone violent for praying, that's coming away pretty clean.
You think you made it out of there because of God, don't you?
She does admit to killing her father. If this were a different show, that would single-handedly be enough to send her to the bad section. For context, her father was an abusive pastor who beat her and eventually killed her mother. In retrospect, this also explains why she was so hard on Jesus guy. Since he was also hurting Ji-young, we have to assume that her murder of him was in self-defense. Having addressed her biggest sin, we would like to discuss two further points in her favor. One is that she didn't get herself in debt. She was afraid of her father's debtors coming after her, and she had nowhere else to go but the game. This means that, despite the trauma of her past, she wasn't the one responsible for the destitution that drove her to the games. It leaves her relatively pure in comparison to those with vices that led them down the wrong path, or those who stole money from others. But, of course, how one acts in the games matters more than how they get there. What we feel elevates Ji-young to this position is the fact that she sacrifices herself for Sang-byuk. Though at first, her disinterest in the fatal game of marbles doesn't make much sense, we eventually see that she's prying for information. She gets a couple of things off her own chest before she dies, but most importantly, she gets the story of her partner. Seeing that Player 67 is not just an ice queen, but a person, leads her to make the greatest sacrifice of all. Since Sang-byuk has someone to return to on the outside, Ji-young willingly loses the game in an attempt to reunite them. Just below her is Ali Abdul, aka Player 199. He has an opportunity during the fifth and fatal marble game to make the same sacrifice that Ji Young made. He doesn't take it, at least not on purpose. But Ali is one of the purest characters ever to grace the games or our screens. What we find so impressive about him is that he's good-natured. The few selfish decisions he makes is an attempt to survive the games that are clearly the hardest for him, and he makes them not for himself, but for his family. A perfect example of this is in the pilot episode during the titular game of Red Light, Green Light. After Ji-hoon trips, Ali reaches out and holds him steady during the red light. This was dangerous not only for Ji-hoon, but also Ali himself. If he had moved too much trying to hold the stranger aloft, or God forbid, fallen with him, he would have been shot dead. But in a split-second decision, he shows his true colors and reaches his hand out to save a man whom he's never met, risking his own life to do so. He is so sincere and grateful for every opportunity he is given. When Sang-woo lends him his phone and then gives him bus fare, he can't stop tripping over his thank yous. He's so happy to be on a team during the games. Every extra bit of food given his way is something that he shows his appreciation for and tries to repay. Much like Ji Young, it's not his fault he's in the games. He moves to Korea to make more opportunities for growing his family. It's his boss that's been working him to the bone with no pay and his own loyalty that leads him down the road of debt. And he didn't even kill anybody, not even in self-defense. So why is he below player 240? It's actually not because he fails to make the same sacrifice. We wouldn't expect that of anyone. And even so, he almost did. When playing the game of marbles against Sang-woo, Ali tries to forfeit.
I would like to play with someone else.
Shut up and keep playing with me, come on.
Surely he knows that doing so will end with him being shot, but his instincts say to do it, and he makes the attempt. It isn't until Sang-woo forces him to keep playing and gives him the opportunity to think it through that he realizes he has to do everything in his power to make it home to his wife. It's actually because of the accident at work. For those of you that have forgotten about the bloody and surprising hand-crushing scene in episode 2, you're welcome for the reminder. When Ali goes to confront his boss about his paychecks, there's a little industrial accident. While we don't blame him entirely for that, he does use the opportunity to grab the stack of cash and make a break for it. It's hard to know what any of us would have done in his shoes. Obviously, this is a man who is just doing what he feels he needs to do for his family, but it was not one of his finer moments, especially since his wife could very well take the blame for his actions. And he never tells her where he's going or gives her any warning of how dangerous the games are before going back to compete again. Following Ali is Wong Jung-ho, the cop. We have to say, his dedication to his brother is amazing. There were so many times he could have tapped out of the idiotic suicide mission he was on, and not once did he elect to do so. Not only that, but when he believes his brother to already be dead, he doesn't give up or try to save himself. He continues to investigate and confirm rather than just trying to make it out of that hellhole alive. Unfortunately, his bravery crosses the border into stupidity. It's obvious he doesn't entirely believe Ji-hoon's story about high stakes red light, green light. Who would, right? But he believed in the lead enough to know that he was going into a dangerous, possibly deadly kidnapping scenario. And he didn't call for backup. He didn't take anything with him that could be easily traced. He didn't even let any of his coworkers, who are police officers, know what he was up to. Not only could he have potentially saved himself, he could have potentially caught the people responsible for the games and saved dozens of contestants.
Tell me everything you know about the game.
When we saw him sneaking into one of those uniforms, we thought he was there to play hero. It turns out he was just waiting for his own untimely demise like the others. Still, his intentions were good. Even if his execution, no pun intended, left a lot to be desired, he was fighting for the side of good. It speaks volumes that he doesn't try to save himself at the end or let his brother recruit him for the games. Rounding out the tier, we have Ji-hoon, aka Player 456. Being the protagonist for a morally ambiguous series like Squid Game is somewhat of a double-edged sword for Ji-hoon's placement on the list. Because he's the most fleshed out and he has the most acts to look over, he's one of the only candidates we could have made a case for being in any section of the list. Ji-hoon is not a good man, but he wants to be. He tries to be. He's afflicted with the pains and vices that come with the mortal experience. Over and over again, we see him try and fail to get better. What makes his story so compelling is that it's not a linear redemption arc as we may expect, but a constant series of trials. He passes some, he fails others, he's unapologetically human. He is none too impressive when we first meet him. He's mooching off of his mother, contributing little to the household, and taking what he has for granted. He steals money that he can't spare and then uses it to gamble with. He's millions of won in debt and he forgets his daughter's birthday.
Looks like the real deal, doesn't it?
This gives us the impression of a bottom-of-the-barrel experience, but that's before we've seen him commit any of his real crimes of this series. Most of his crimes come paired with acts of tremendous sacrifice, just not always in the right order. Sometimes he makes the sacrifice first and then acts selfishly, thus undoing them. For example, let's talk about how he cheated in the game of marbles. Always that damn game of marbles, huh? Like it or not, episode 6 was the perfect morality test, and Ji-hoon failed hard. His first trial comes when the math teacher offers to partner with him. In this instance, he makes the correct moral decision and chooses to partner with player 1 instead. Though he, like everyone, believes this will put him at a disadvantage, he knows that his friend is struggling and likely won't survive on his own. He takes the risk to himself by partnering with Il-nam in an attempt to save the old man. Unfortunately, the decision quickly comes back to haunt him. When it's made apparent that only one half of each team will be moving on, Ji-hoon knows it will come down to him or player 1, whose mental state rapidly seems to be deteriorating. And you know where this is going. When player 1 starts getting confused, or more accurately, faking confusion, Ji-hoon begins to cheat. We understand why he did it. The old man had a fatal tumor, was sick, and didn't seem likely to make it through any more games. It's understandable that Ji-hoon, who is trying to make it back to his mother, doesn't want to die for his partner who doesn't even see what's happening around him. But by cheating in the game, he knew that he was going to be killing a friend he had set out to protect. It was a huge betrayal of trust. It made it hurt all the more when Il-nam gives him the last marble in his right mind and of his own volition. The other biggest drawback we had with deeming player 456 as good was the year after he wins. He comes back with a nasty case of PTSD and is planning to help all the people he fought for, and all the people his fallen allies had fought for. When he gets back to the apartment to find his mother dead, it's clear that something in him snaps. For the first year, he doesn't touch all that money he won. He continues a life where he begs for scraps and sleeps outside and doesn't take care of himself.
Please spare me just 10,000 won.
His life is considerably worse than when he went into the games, despite the fact he came out very wealthy. It's hard to imagine what all he's going through, but during that year, there were other people who suffered. Sang-woo gave up his life so that Ji-hoon could leave with the money, and his last request was that Ji-hoon look after his mother. Sang-byuk, on her deathbed, pleaded with him to get her little brother out of the orphanage. That one was a particularly time-sensitive issue. While Ji-hoon does eventually see to both of those things, he lets Chiyo sit in that place with no word of his sister for a year. He never even attempts to bring closure to Sang-woo's mother about her son's death. He does the right thing eventually, but again, the redemption arc wasn't a complete success. He met another bump in the road and he let it ruin everything for a full year during which his obligations went unmet. And for a little boy, it's an awful thing to lose a year of your childhood. Of course, there are many defining moments in his favor. He gets the team together, he looks after player 1, he tries to make sure that 67 feels safe, even though she's stolen 4 million won from him on the outside. The biggest redeeming moment was when he tried to quit the game. When his victory was all but assured, the money as good as his, he tried to lift up the friend who had betrayed him so horrendously. Despite knowing what Sang-woo was capable of, despite being filled with rage about Sang-bok's murder, and despite needing the money, he chose to have his friend alive rather than to claim victory for himself in the Squid Game. The good acts don't always balance out the bad, and there were plenty of bad decisions on Ji-hoon's record. But the series asks the question, is humanity good? And call us crazy, but we've decided to put the most human character in our good tier. Take that bet, ill numb. With that said, our good section comes to a close. We are now entering the gray area to feature characters caught in the center of our moral spectrum. Kicking off this tier, we have Seong Byeok. She is a character with outstanding qualities. Arguably, she deserved to win the game the most. She has been a victim of circumstance her entire life, and things only seem to get worse for her when she takes them into her own hands. For a character that is so easily motivated into death games for money, she's incredibly selfless. Like Ali, she is trying to win the money for her family. She wants her little brother out of the orphanage and her mother brought safely into the country. Admirable goals. During the game, she sticks mostly to herself. She's a team player only when she needs to be, during tug of war, for instance. But she doesn't make the mistake of relying on anyone. She challenges Sang-woo to bring another outcast into the fold and doesn't team up with Jok-su even when she's invited to do so.
He liked to pick all of his little minions' pockets just so he could fill up his own.
What brings her down into the gray category actually has nothing to do with her time in the games. It's the life of crime leading up to them. Jok-su was clearly taking advantage of and grooming her on the outside. He was an established crime boss and had recruited her and taught her the skill she used to eventually steal the 4 million won from Ji-hoon. A lot of that we blame on him even after she goes independent. There are some problems with this, of course. One is that she's stealing the money from people who also need it. The other one is that we don't entirely believe pickpocketing is her only sin. While her hand-to-hand combat skills get her beaten up on day one of the games, she's a little too good with a knife. She's also not afraid to throw boiling coffee on anyone who crosses her, and we don't think she's the kind to make idle threats. Honestly, we're a little afraid of her. While her motivations are some of the purest on the show, her actions definitely are not. Up next is the Doctor. We don't entirely blame him for his bad actions either, and we don't know a ton about him. A doctor that ends up in a place like this is probably hiding something shady anyway, but he's also not the best participant of the games. In fact, he's the only player executed for being unfair during the game. We know that's because he was the only one who was caught cheating, but still. He gets wrapped up in a scheme to harvest body parts from the deceased to make a bit of extra cash for the staff. Now, even for a human death arena, that's a little messed up. We can't give him any credit for joining up with Jok-su either when there were already other teams forming. There were places he could have been just as safe and players who could have used that extra information more. That wasn't our original point, but I guess our new point is that if you're going to cheat, cheat to help other underdogs at least, you know? Following him, Jesus guy. We mean player 244. We don't have a lot to say about him. He's one of our least favorite characters, but it's because he's one of the least interesting. He has very little impact. While we're inclined to put him lower on this list for endangering everyone's lives, being annoying, being sexist, and being a hypocrite, the truth is that we're a little biased.
We're all sinners. But we're still here, aren't we?
We don't know what got him into the games, and it's obvious he's trying to improve himself, even if he is failing. His misdeeds in the game are not so horrendous when compared to everyone else's. And yes, that also goes for some people on the good list. For this reason, and this reason alone, he skates by in the gray area. Rounding out the tier is Han Min-yeol. Following one of our least favorite characters is one of our favorite. She's not written to be as complex as some of the players with more screen time, but damn if she isn't entertaining. Despite not seeming to like Seong Bok much, she does cover for her in the third episode. She's curious, she's quick thinking, and she means what she says, it's Han Min-yeol. Basically, what we're trying to say is that she's good at everything, except things she can't do.
I'm good at everything except the things that I can't do.
And we feel sorry for her, even though we know she'd probably resent us for it. While we know she only gravitates toward Jok-su in attempt to gain his favor and some protection, she needed a bond with someone to make it through the games. She chose very poorly and was cast aside. She also gets herself into trouble with her next team. She doesn't know how to climb up without pulling others down. She often describes the other woman in the group as weak or wimpy and implies that she's the only good woman to have on the team. She also tries to get Ali booted from the tug of war team because she has a problem with immigrants. So there are definitely bad qualities there. But she murders Jok-su, something that she's been promising to do for a few episodes. When they're crossing the glass bridge, she takes the opportunity to do it. but she strikes at an opportune moment where killing her former lover will actually save everyone behind him in the line. While we don't think she's a great person, she is leaps and bounds above those in our next tier. Finally, we're about to enter the dark side. Welcome to the bad to evil characters. Surprisingly, we'll be starting this off with Sang-woo. Bet you didn't see that coming, did ya? We certainly didn't. It wasn't until we were going over the others with a fine-tooth comb that we realized Sang-woo is the best among the bad, if that's a title to be proud of. Our points here are almost the exact opposite of the points that we made about Ji-hoon, which makes sense as the two characters operate so differently. Sang-woo is inherently a very selfish person who is more effective at doing the right thing. Let us explain. Leading up to the final episode of Squid Game, Sang-woo is the worst of the worst. He scammed people out of billions of won despite having all the prospects for a legitimate life. He's intelligent, charming, he went to business school, he had a bright future. He scammed and gambled it all into oblivion, using his mother's home and shop as collateral before failing spectacularly. Like we said, selfish. This is also reflected during his actions in the game. Despite the fact that he was trying to kill himself before being readmitted, he values no one's life above his own. With little trifles such as bus fare and breakfast bread, he is a very generous and open-handed. When it comes to who lives and dies, he shows no hesitation in putting his own life first. It makes us wonder if those little favors aren't calculated on his part. Notice how he uses past examples of his own generosity to try and convince Ollie to die for him?
Hey, come on, if you help me! Then there's a way that both of us can live.
When that doesn't work, he is quick to scam Ollie and exit the games intact. He also throws a man to his death in the bridge game. While the game of Honeycomb proves to be fatal for no one on his team, he feigns ignorance of what they're playing and intentionally misleads the people who trust him while taking the easiest shape for himself. That one wasn't even necessary for him, he just didn't help them. And of course, he kills Sang-byuk. He says he put her out of her misery, he says he was scared that they would outvote him and leave. But she was in the same rough boat as them, and it wasn't like she was his first victim. Sang-woo was a killer through and through, and we're not surprised he made it to the sixth round. Like we said, his act of redemption was more successful than Ji-hoon's. Ji-hoon is willing to walk away from all the prize money so that Sang-woo can leave with him. Sang-woo is willing to die so that the prize money still goes to Ji-hoon after it's clear he had lost the game. This one act of selflessness was enough to pull him up from the bottom of the list. But notice that it didn't make him good or even gray. That's because, as always, Sang-woo knew what he was doing. Despite the fact that his friend was telling him he'd rather walk away than lose anyone else, Sang-woo chose to kill himself. He did it with instructions, too, to take care of his mother. In this ending to the game, he still gets what he was playing for, the chance to see his family taken care of. Even though it's Sang-woo who dies, it's Ji-hoon who has to pay the price for it. Next was an easier choice, Gyeok-su. Listen, this is a bad guy. Were it not for Sang-woo surprising us so much during the Squid Game, he would have been at the top of the bad section. He's violent, he's selfish, he knows he's strong enough to get away with bullying others into submission at every turn. He betrays Han Mi Neo after sleeping with her and getting her help with the honeycomb. He's willing to let everyone die on the glass bridge just so he doesn't have to risk his own skin.
You wanna go so bad? Go ahead.
And that's not even counting the people he encourages to do his murdering for him. Even the other criminals that he runs with on the outside are done putting up with his shit. They're trying to kill him before he gets a chance to re-enter the game. And honestly, we don't blame them. Not everyone in the show can be as complex or subtle as Sang-woo. Some people are bad just for the sake of being bad, and that perfectly describes him. We move now to our shortest entry, the frontman, aka Hwang In-ho. The frontman is a mystery, so much of a mystery that we almost didn't put him here on what is supposed to be a broad strokes cast ranking. But he's one of the most felt presence on the show, and leaving him off didn't feel right either. But understand, this is a tentative ranking. We don't know much of anything regarding how In-ho got recruited or why he's taking the position of the game's frontman.
Every player gets to play a fair game under the same conditions.
Between his minimal dialogue and the mask he wears almost the whole show, he's the most enigmatic character. He's in the bad section for his involvement in the games and the leading role he takes in that environment. Of course, he doesn't win any good points for shooting his brother. That was the most emotive he was during the entire show, so we do think he struggled with the decision. We're inclined to give him the tiniest piece of credit because he does try to recruit Jun-ho rather than kill him. It's Jun-ho's stubbornness that gets him shot. But honestly, would corrupting his very pure brother be that much of an improvement? In the penultimate spot may be another shocker, Il-Nam, aka Player One. We know, he's supposed to be the big bad guy. This is one of TV's biggest twists that we absolutely should have seen coming, but didn't. All the way from red light, green light, it was obvious Player One was just having the time of his life. But we just didn't think he could be involved. Not someone so helpful and nice and, well, childlike. Considering the fact that he's essentially the show's main antagonist, you might expect the revelation that he's the brains of the operation to drop him to the bottom of the list. And you might not like what saves him. He's crazy. Hear us out. While Il-Nam was supposed to be the host of the Korean Games and is open with Ji-hoon about his involvement in founding the entire operation, he wasn't working alone. There are other crazy rich people who are entertained by the thought of peasants dying for their amusement. It's awful. We don't condone it, and we absolutely don't forgive Il-Nam for participating. But he, unlike the other mysterious 1% that lives off screen somewhere, has one aspect to his madness that makes him more sympathetic than his peers. He participates. He's not in this to watch people die for his amusement. The draw for him isn't the suffering or the money. He wants to be in the games. He wants the high-stakes, immersive feeling he had as a child. Again, to be crystal clear on this, we're not condoning his actions. The ends don't justify the means. 454 people should not have had to die just to give this old billionaire some fleeting joy. But the fact that he's also willing to put himself into danger, that he experiences the games from on the ground with the others, and the slightly less evil motives means that we just couldn't put him at the bottom. So, who is worse, you ask? Especially since we never get to see the other founders. The most evil slot of the show has to go to the VIPs. We started with a group, it's only fair we end with another group. And we've chosen the VIPs.
I just have to say that I'm a difficult man to please.
Unlike Il-Nam, who creates the game so he can participate, these are rich assholes who just want to see the suffering. They are treating human beings like racehorses, betting on their lives for amusement. The whole group takes the slot, but we've a special hatred for VIP 4, the one in the golden tiger mask who is ultimately subdued by Jun-ho. Because while it's one thing to pay millions to watch people die for you, it's another thing entirely to do that and then get so bored that you have to sexually abuse the staff as well. There are people in this world worse than them, those who helped establish and run the other games. The implication is that other countries have hosts and there are more Korean clients that we never get to see. But since that isn't confirmed, come on season 2, the VIPs will have to stand in as the worst of the worst. That's been it, the cast of Squid Games ranked from good to evil. Who do you think was the best, the worst, why? Remember to check out our video 10 things to watch if you loved Squid Games over on our horror channel, WickedBinge. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and as always, stay wicked.